Good evening. Hi, everyone. Wow, I'm so glad we're together tonight. Welcome and thank you all for coming. I'm Luis Jaramillo, the director of the Creative Writing Program at the New School. As many of you know, the New School has offered workshops and hosted literary events since 1931. This year, we are celebrating the 20th anniversary of the MFA in Creative Writing. And for at least 16 of those 20 years, we've had the honor of hosting the finalist readings the evening before the National Book Awards. This is always a special evening, not least because we at the New School share the National Book Foundation's mission to celebrate the vast diversity of literature and to expand its audience. I'd like to give a heartfelt thanks to Pam Tillis, Lori Lynn Turner, Laura Kronk, Ben Fama, Glenn Pogue, Mickey Meinhardt, Brian Case, and Sylvan Simon, and many others. And I'd also like to express my personal gratitude for one of the finalists, Congressman John Lewis. I want to thank you for your decades of civil rights activism and for your service as a congressman. Thank you for taking the time to be with us tonight. And thank you in advance for the necessary work you'll do when you get back to Washington. I promise, and I hope the rest of us promise, that we'll do the work too. So, yeah. Thank you to our friends at the National Book Foundation, and it is now my pleasure to invite to the stage Lisa Lucas, Executive Director of the National Book Foundation. Welcome, Lisa.
Thank you, Luis. So first off, I'm Lisa Lucas. I'm the new executive director at the National Book Foundation. We've been coming here for 16 years, they tell me. This is my first time here, but we're really grateful to the New School for this opportunity to bring all of our finalists together the night before the National Book Awards and to share with the public the incredible work that they have written. And so thank you so much to Dean Watson, to Luis, and to Lori Lynn for once again letting us have this event here. This year, we've had a tough week, I'd say. No matter where you stand on the political spectrum, we have realized that the country is divided. But I think that the literature that we're here to celebrate tonight unites us, no matter who we are. All 20 of these books. Are profoundly impactful in so many different ways. Some of them let us laugh. Some of them let us think about how we love. Some of them let us think about how we ignore one another. Some of them think directly about history and how politics have shifted and evolved. But each and every one of them is important and meaningful and beautiful. And so in a week where some of us are not feeling especially celebratory, and some of us are feeling scared and unhappy, I'm really, really grateful to every single person in this audience for showing up here to actually celebrate something that matters. The National Book Foundation is an organization that celebrates and promotes reading all year long. But the National Book Awards, which will take place tomorrow night, are the power center from which we work all year long. And so when we work with students, when we work with colleges, when we work with organizations that promote literary activism, it all is based on the fact that we celebrate every year 20 books as our finalists, and they're all here to read to you tonight. And they're all going to be really lovely and read for 3 minutes. They promised me. Make sure you read these books. They're all incredible. They are all truly incredible. The entire staff at the National Book Foundation has been reading and loving and learning from these books for the past goodness knows how long. And we encourage you to not just listen to what's being read to you today, but to actually go outside and buy books in the lobby when it's done, or to buy books at your local bookstore or take them out at your library, but read them. They will make your lives better. And so tonight, in order to help us celebrate these books. We have two tremendous and very snazzily dressed hosts who have promised to scold everyone who reads more than 3 minutes. Isaac Fitzgerald and Saeed Jones from BuzzFeed are here to help us. These two gentlemen are passionate, political, literary, and dedicated, and they evangelize for the power of literature every day. And so we're so thrilled to have them celebrate our big night tonight. Isaac Fitzgerald has been a firefighter. He's worked on a boat. He's been given a sword by a king, thereby accomplishing 3 out of 5 of his childhood goals. What are the rest of them? He's the editor of BuzzFeed Books and co-author of Pen and Ink, Tattoos and the Stories Behind Them, and Knives and Ink, Chefs and the Story Behind Their Tattoos with Recipes. And there you can find more at isaacfitzgerald.net. Saeed Jones' debut poetry collection, Prelude to Bruise, by Coffeehouse Press, was the winner of the 2015 Penn Joyce Osterweil Award for Poetry and the 2015 Stonewall Book Award, Barbara Giddings Literature Award, and a final for the 2015 National Book Critics Circle Award. The book was also a finalist for 2015 awards from the Lambda Literary and Publishing Triangle. His work has appeared in publications like the New York Times, NPR, and Tin House, among others. Saeed won a Pushcart Prize for Poetry in 2013, and he is BuzzFeed's Executive Editor of Culture. He's also hilarious and wonderful on Twitter every single day. And so now, let us bring Isaac and Saeed up to the front to kick us off for a lovely night of literature. Thank you all very much.
Please give it up for Lisa Lucas.
Hello, I am Saeed Jones, poet, editor, recent survivor of the 2016 presidential election. It's an honor to have made it this far. Is this Isaac Fitzgerald?
Hi, Isaac Fitzgerald, also a survivor, also just incredibly happy to be here with you all here at the New School. Let's give it up to the New School.
There's not much to say except that this is exactly where we both want to be, both with my best friend and with my other best friend, Art. Art always answers, and it is a thrill to be a part of this celebration. Are we ready?
Logistics.
Are you ready? Okay, mission control. Mission control, because I have Wi-Fi access, and if you read over, I will tweet about it. You two congressmen, look. Okay, so the readers are divided into 4 groups. We will come up to the stage and read each group's name all together, but the writers will come one at a time, and you can follow the order in your program. Here's the order.
So pay attention, readers.
This is very important. Nonfiction, young people's literature, poetry, and fiction.
Is there going to be a break in the middle?
There will be a 5-minute intervention. 5 minutes halfway through, and each of our amazing finalists will read for 3 to 4 minutes, okay? The punishment for overreading is a spot in Trump's cabinet, so. The choice is yours. Okay, but before we get to this, I would like to ask all of our finalists to stand and let us celebrate them. Congratulations.
Please stand and face the crowd.
Are you ready for the best show in town? All right, our first group of readers will be the finalists for nonfiction. And here are their names. Ibram X. Kendi.
Andrés Reséndez.
Arlie Russell Hochschild.
Viet Thanh Nguyen.
and Heather Ann Thompson. They will come to the stage one at a time, men. Please welcome them to the stage.
Good evening. I guess I'll bite the bullet and go first. My name is Ibram X. Kendi, and I'm the author of Stamped from the Beginning. And the excerpt that I'm going to read comes from the epilogue of Stamped from the Beginning, the definitive history of racist ideas in America. Anti-racists should stop connecting selfishness to racism and unselfishness to anti-racism. Altruism is not required. Anti-racists do not have to be altruistic. Anti-racists do not have to be selfless. Anti-racists merely have to have intelligent self-interest and to stop consuming those racist ideas that have engendered so much unintelligent self-interest over the years. It is in the intelligent self-interest of middle and upper-income blacks to challenge the racism affecting the black poor, knowing that they will not be free of racism that is slowing their socioeconomic rise until poor blacks are free of racism. It is in the intelligent self-interest of Asians, Native Americans, and Latinos to challenge anti-black racism, knowing that they will not be free of racism until black people are free of racism. It is in the intelligent self-interest of white Americans to challenge racism, knowing they will not be free of sexism, class bias, homophobia, and ethnocentrism until black people are free of racism. The histories of anti-Asian, anti-Native, and anti-Latino racist ideas, the histories of sexist, elitist, homophobic, and ethnocentric ideas all sound eerily similar to this history of racist ideas and feature some of the same defenders of bigotry in America. Supporting these prevailing bigotries is only in the intelligent self-interest of a tiny group of super rich Protestant, heterosexual, non-immigrant, white, Anglo-Saxon males. Those are the only people who need to be altruistic in order to be anti-racist. The rest of us merely need to do the intelligent thing for ourselves. Historically, black people have, by and large, figured the smartest thing we could do for ourselves is to partake in uplift suasion, a strategy as unworkable as white self-sacrifice. Beginning around the 1790s, abolitionists urged a growing number of free blacks to exhibit upstanding behavior before white people, believing they would thereby undermine the racist beliefs behind slavery. Black people would acquire, quote, the esteem, confidence, and patronage of the whites in proportion to your increase in knowledge and moral improvement, as William Lloyd Garrison lectured free blacks in the 1830s. The history of racist ideas shows not only that uplift suasion has failed, but that generally speaking, the opposite of its intended effect has occurred. Racist Americans have routinely despised those black Americans the most who uplifted themselves, who defied those racist laws and theories that individuals employed to keep them down. So upwardly mobile black folk have not persuaded away racist ideas or policies, quite the contrary. Uplift suasion has brought on the progression of racism, new racist policies and ideas after blacks broke through the old ones. Everyone who has witnessed the historic presidency of Barack Obama and the historic opposition to him should know full well that the more black people uplift themselves, the more they will find themselves on the receiving end of a racist backlash. Uplift suasion as a strategy of racial progress has failed. Black individuals must dispose of it as a strategy and stop worrying about what other people may think about the way they act, the way they speak, the way they look, the way they dress, the way they are portrayed in the media, and the way they think and love and laugh. Individual blacks are not race representatives. They are not responsible for those Americans who hold racist ideas. Black people need to be their imperfect selves around white people, around each other, around all people. Black is beautiful and ugly, intelligent and unintelligent, law-abiding and law-breaking, industrious and lazy, and it is those imperfections that make black people human, make black people equal to all other imperfectly human groups. Thank you.
Okay, good evening. My name is Andrés Reséndez, and I'm the author of The Other Slavery, The Uncovered Story of Indian Enslavement in America. And I have a fragment from the introduction rather than the conclusion. And it is said as I start realizing the magnitude of this topic. And this is what I wrote. The more I learned, the more I became convinced that Indian slavery had been a defining aspect of North American societies. And yet, it has been almost completely erased from our historical memory. At last count, there were more than 15,000 books on African slavery, whereas only a couple of dozen specialized monographs were devoted to Indian slavery. To be sure, some scholars have broached the topic of labor coercion in considerable detail, but such work is often subdivided on their various rubrics. The end result is a failure to grasp the common threads running through all of these institutions and gain a better appreciation of their combined scope. The consequences are plainly visible today. Whenever the conversation turns to slavery, people typically imagine black slaves. Hardly ever does anyone think of Indians. It is as if each group fits into a neat historical package. Africans were enslaved, and Indians either died off or were dispossessed and confined to reservations. Such an oversimplification is troublesome because Indian slavery actually explains a great deal about the shared history of Mexico and the United States and casts new light on even familiar events. If we want to find answers to such varied questions as why the Pueblo Indians of New Mexico launched a massive rebellion in 1680 and drove the Spaniards out of New Mexico, why the Comanches and Utes became so dominant in large areas of the West, why the Apache chief Geronimo hated Mexicans so much, why Article 11 of the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo prohibited Americans from purchasing, quote, Mexican captives held by the savage tribes, end of quote, why California, Utah, and New Mexico legalized Indian slavery, disguising it as servitude or dead peonage, or why so many Navajos appear in New Mexico's baptismal records in the aftermath of Colonel Kit Carson's Navajo campaigns of 1863-1864, we have to come to terms with the reality of these other slavery. Anyone who reads about the history of northern Mexico or the American Southwest will invariably run into indigenous rebellions prompted by exploitation, raids on Indian communities, and labor coercion. And yet, it remains hard to see the forest for the trees. Lacking a sense of the overarching system of enslavement, it is impossible to put such scattered and localized practices in their proper places, just as it would be extremely difficult to make sense of the kidnappings or intertribal warfare of West Africa without reference to the transatlantic slave trade. With the other slavery, I hope to provide a broad but detailed portrait of the system of native enslavement that loomed over North America for four centuries and is a key missing piece of this continental history. Thank you.
My book takes us into the back bayous of Louisiana, where a number of people that I came to know over 5 years ended up voting for Donald Trump. They had experienced a lot of loss of a way of life, of a sense of honor, and in this petrochemical center of the country and one of the most polluted spots on earth, a loss of trees. I'm sitting on a soft living room couch in the home of Harold Areno, a gentle Cajun pipe fitter who's carefully holding before me from his adjacent chair a large photo album. He draws his hand back and forth over the plastic covers of the black and white photos. He turns the pages slowly, searching for one. 71, a former deacon in the Lighthouse Tabernacle, Pentecostal church. He's dressed in a plaid shirt and jeans. He speaks in a slow baritone, his eyes on the page, often concluding a line with a thought with a light chuckle as if to say, it's all right. He points, there it is, his mother, father, himself, and 9 siblings standing in 2 rows, squinting into the sun on the banks of Bayou Den. It is 1950. Harold names his brothers and sisters. He tells how his mother used to catch gar by coaxing the fish to the side of the boat with bait, patting their sides, and then lifting them out by the gills into the boat. He turns to the next page of his album slowly. Now the photo of his father and siblings, all born and raised just across Bayou Den. Now in different constellations, family is picnicking, clowning, now swimming, now dropping a watermelon off the boat to play with in the water and later eat. But it's not just his family he wants me to see. As if introducing friends, he points beyond the family to something else, standing proud in the water, behind the faces in the photos, are commanding bald cypress trees, large triangular trunks rising from the water, once the glorious queens of the forested wetlands of southern Louisiana and still the official state bird. Green moss hangs from the outstretched lower branches, tree after tree, like lace shawls in a dance hall. They were so tall, the sun hardly hit the marsh. Harold's father had built fishing boats, and he'd watched over a bridge. And otherwise, he fished and farmed. Throw a cage in the swamp, Harold chuckles, his eyebrows lifted for emphasis, and he can make a living. But that was before. Now, the last paragraph of my book where I'm saying goodbye to people. On my last visit to Harold and Annette Reno on Bayou Den, Harold told me he couldn't be sure, but these days maybe the water was looking a little bit cleaner. Then he kindly walked me across his driveway and opened my car door. I got in and opened the window on the driver's side. Now, in his mid-80s, Harold looked out to his beloved bayou, where once majestic cypress had held out their moss shawls, I recalled. Then Harold leaned on the window and told me slowly, I don't know when I'll see you next. Only the angel Gabriel knows when each of our times comes. But when it does, and gravity leaves our feet, and we rise up, I know I'll see you there. And they say there are beautiful trees in heaven.
I'm Viet Thanh Nguyen, author of Nothing Ever Dies, Vietnam and the Memory of War. I was born in Vietnam, but made in America. I count myself among those Vietnamese dismayed by America's deeds, but tempted to believe in its words. I also count myself among those Americans who often do not know what to make of Vietnam and want to know what to make of it. Americans, as well as many people the world over, tend to mistake Vietnam with the war named in its honor or dishonor, as the case may be. This confusion has no doubt led to some of my own uncertainties about what it means to be a man with two countries, as well as the inheritor of two revolutions. Today, the Vietnamese and American revolutions manufacture memories, only to absolve the hardening of their arteries. For those of us who consider ourselves to be inheritors of one or both of these revolutions, or who've been influenced by them in some way, we have to know how we make memories and how we forget them so that we can beat their hearts back to life. That is the project, or at least the hope, of this book. That was from the beginning of the book, and now I'm going to read from the end. Remembering and forgetting entwined together, a double helix making us who we are, one never without the other. I want to remember, but so much has been forgotten or silenced. My own personal memory is faulty. Through my youth, I had a memory of soldiers firing from our boat onto another boat as we floated on the South China Sea. I was 4. My brother, 7 years older, says the shooting never happened. As an adult, I remembered my mother being hospitalized when I was a child. A few years ago, when I discovered a memoir that I had written in college, I read in my own words that she was in the hospital at that time, not years before. Her illness in that strange ward with its mumbling patients had made me feel like I was a frightened child. That feeling was what I remembered. As for my father, it's pointless to ask him about the past. His relationship to the past is to muffle it, at least in my presence. Although I've visited his homeland, I've never visited my own origin, the town where I was born, because he has forbidden it. More than once, he has said to me, "You can never go back there." Too many people will remember him and persecute me, or so he believes. I think of what the cartoonist Art Spiegelman said of his father, who survived the Holocaust. "I hadn't a clue," Spiegelman says, "as to how to find the places my father had been telling me he grew up in, and he wasn't of much help, except to tell us not to go at all, because they kill Jews there." Using the present tense, "They kill Jews there, don't go." He was afraid for us. Like Spiegelman's father, my own must believe in rememories that do not die, those mnemonic menaces that retain their fatal force. And while I've disobeyed my father in many things, I cannot in this one thing. The paternal injunction is too strong, the specter of the unknown past too unsettling. What is it that he remembers of this place? What will he not tell me? What if he is right? This absence as a forbidding presence is the opposite of memory. Perhaps some things will never be remembered and yet also never forgotten. Perhaps some things will remain unspoken and yet always heard. Perhaps I will only visit where I was born after my father has passed on. Then it will be too late to see what it is he remembers, the memory having at last expired. This is the paradox of the past, of trauma, of loss, of war. A true war story where there is no ending but the unknown, no conversation except that which cannot be finished. I think back to my father's father and what happened to his remains. The Vietnamese believe a person should be buried twice. The first time, in a field removed from home and village, the earth eats the flesh. The second time, the survivors must disinter what remains. If they have timed it correctly, there will only be bones. If they've timed it wrong, there will still be flesh. Regardless of what they find, they must wash the bones with their own hands. Then they bury the bones once more, this time closer to the living. Thank you.
I begin my book with a bit of my own history, explaining why it took so long, more than a decade, for me to research and write the story of Attica and its legacy. As I write in the prologue, the answer is actually quite simple. The most important details of the story have been deliberately kept from the public. Literally thousands of boxes of documents relating to these events are sealed or next to impossible to access. And yet Attica survivors refused to remain silent, and thus, thankfully, the story could be told via them. And also, very thankfully, thanks to two incredibly lucky breaks, I eventually managed to see critical files and wrenching artifacts that finally illuminated to me the full horror and hope of Attica, stories that even the survivors did not know. Notably, all of those files and artifacts have since disappeared. But as I pledge to the reader, all that I learned in those documents can't be unlearned, and all of the boxes of bloody Attica clothes and heartbreaking letters written by Attica's prisoners that I saw can't be unseen. And so my book begins. The first passage I will share describes the very first night of the Attica uprising, as nearly 1,300 men have just found themselves quite suddenly waging one of the 20th century's most extraordinary human rights protests. Despite a sense of foreboding, there were moments of levity, and for some, even a feeling of unexpected joy as men who hadn't felt the fresh air of night for years reveled in this strange freedom. Out in the dark, music could be heard, drums, a guitar, vibes, sax that the brothers were playing. That night was also a deeply emotional time for all of them. Richard Clark watched in amazement as men embraced each other, and he saw one man break down because it had been so long since he'd been allowed to be close to someone. Carlos Roche watched as tears of elation ran down the withered face of his friend Owl, an old man who'd been locked up for decades. "You know," Owl said in wonderment, "I haven't seen the stars in 22 years." While there was much trepidation about what might occur next, the men in D-Yard felt wonderful because no matter what happened later on, they couldn't take this night away from us. What happened later on was that the state of New York decided to retake Attica with unimaginable force. And this from that section. Up on the catwalk, prisoners and hostages alike waiting with hearts pounding for what might happen next. Wobbling slightly, hostage Mike Smith began having a serious discussion with one of the prisoners by his side, Don Noble. With the minutes ticking by, Mike and Don both expressed deep sadness that the last 4 days had come down to this. They made a solemn pact that if anything happened to either one of them, they would find the other's family members and make sure that they knew how much they were loved. Mike told Don about a note he'd managed to pen to his wife Sharon, now hidden deep in his wallet. Don promised to deliver it if they made it out alive. Seconds later, Mike Smith and Don Noble heard a sound that sent a chill down their spines. It was the ominous roar of a helicopter, its blades revving up. Besides being able to hear it, Mike recalled in horror, you could actually feel the concussion of the propellers. And then more than 600 heavily armed and angry troopers and corrections officers stormed Attica. What followed was literally a bloodbath, a massacre. And then for the next many days, months, and decades, I hope that the reader witnesses the most incomprehensibly thorough state effort to protect its own unfold, to make sure that no member of law enforcement would ever be held accountable, and that Attica would be forever associated with the savagery of prisoners, not the police. And yet, as my book shows, I hope, the lesson of Attica is not that of the triumph of repression. Rather, it is about the quite incredible power of resistance. From the epilogue. America's incarcerated people have never stopped struggling against the country's most punitive penal practices. The Attica Uprising of 1971 shows the nation that even the most marginalized citizens will never stop fighting to be treated as human beings. Attica testifies to this irrepressible demand for justice. This is Attica's legacy. Thank you.
Another round of applause for our nonfiction finalists. Amazing work. Amazing
work. And again, I just want to emphasize how important it is that we're here tonight. This is a reading. We live in New York City, a lot of us that are here tonight, but you don't get a reading series like this. You don't get a reading series filled with some of the best writers of the year. So again, this is just such a wonderful place. It's so wonderful to be sharing these moments with you. With that said, actually, you know what? Let's give it up for the National Book Foundation.
Oh. That sentence could have gone anywhere. Really, no. It's time for young people's literature.
That's correct. Kate DiCamillo.
Congressman John Lewis, Andrew Aydin, and Nate Powell.
Grace Lynn.
Jason Reynolds.
Nicola Yoon.
Sorry. I'm Kate DiCamillo. The book is Ramey Nightingale, Chapter 1. There were three of them, three girls. They were standing side by side. They were standing at attention. And then the girl in the pink dress, the one who was standing right next to Ramey, let out a sob and said, "The more I think about it, the more terrified I am. I'm too terrified to go on." The girl clutched her baton to her chest and dropped to her knees. Ramey stared at her in wonder and admiration. She herself often felt too terrified to go on, but she had never admitted it out loud. The girl in the pink dress moaned and toppled over sideways. Her eyes fluttered closed. She was silent, and then she opened her eyes very wide and shouted, "Archie, I'm sorry. I'm sorry I betrayed you." She closed her eyes again. Her mouth fell open. Raimi had never seen or heard anything like it. "I'm sorry," Raimi whispered, "I betrayed you." For some reason, the words seemed worth repeating. "Stop this nonsense immediately," said Ida Nee. Ida Nee was the baton twirling instructor, even though she was old, over 50 at least. Her hair was an extremely bright yellow. She wore white boots that came all the way up to her knees. "I'm not kidding," said Ida Nee. Raimi believed her. Ida Nee didn't seem like much of a kidder. The sun was way, way up in the sky, and the whole thing was like high noon in a Western, but it was not a Western. It was baton twirling lessons at Ida Nee's house in Ida Nee's backyard. It was the summer of 1975. It was the fifth day of June, and 2 days before, on the third day of June, Raimi Clark's father had run away from home with a woman who was a dental hygienist. "Hey, diddle, diddle, the dish ran away with the spoon." Those were the words that went through Raimi's head every time she thought about her father and the dental hygienist. But she did not say the words out loud anymore because Raimi's mother was very upset, and talking about dishes and spoons running away together was not appropriate. It was actually a great tragedy what had happened. That was what Raimi's mother said. "This is a great tragedy," said Raimi's mother. "Quit reciting nursery rhymes." It was a great tragedy because Raimi's father had disgraced himself. It was also a great tragedy because Raimi was now fatherless. The thought of that, the fact of it, that she, Raimi Clark, was without a father, made a small, sharp pain shoot through Raimi's heart every time she considered it. Sometimes the pain in her heart made her feel too terrified to go on. Sometimes it made her want to drop to her knees. But then she would remember that she had a plan. Thank you.
March, book three. When I spoke at the March on Washington on August 28, 1963, I said, "One man, one vote is the African cry. It is ours too. It must be ours." Became the rallying cry for the students, for the young people of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. So after the bombing of the church in Birmingham, on September the 15th, 1963, we intensified our efforts in Selma, Alabama. In Selma, only 1% of African Americans of voting age were registered to vote. In Selma, there was a sheriff by the name of Jim Clark, who wore a gun on one side, a nightstick on the other side, and carried an electric calf rider in his hand, and he didn't use it on cows. We made a decision to march from Selma to Montgomery to dramatize to the nation and to the world that people of color wanted to register to vote. So after a beating and a shooting in a little town of Marion, Alabama, we made a decision to march. Sunday, March 7, 1965, 600 of us left a little church, line up in twos, to walk the 50 miles from Selma to Montgomery. Made it across the bridge. And a major spoke up and said, "Our Major John Cloud of the Alabama State Troopers, this is an unlawful march. You will not be allowed to continue. I give you 3 minutes to disperse and return to your church or to your homes." The young man walking beside me, Jose Williams, said, "Major, give us a moment to kneel and pray." He said, "Troopers advance." I said, "Major, may I have a word?" He said, "There will be no word." You saw these men putting on that gas mask, came toward us, beating us with nightsticks, bull whips, tripping us with horses, and releasing the tear gas. Was hit in the head by a state trooper with a nightstick. Had a concussion at the bridge. I thought I saw death. I thought I was going to die. Because of Selma, we got the Voting Rights Act of 1965, signed into law by President Lyndon Johnson. March, Book 3.
Thank you, Congressman. I'm going to take us back to September 18th, 1963, 3 days after the bombing of the 16th Street Baptist Church, in the sanctuary of that same church, for the funerals of four girls murdered by the white supremacists in that bombing: Addie Mae Collins, Carol Robertson, Cynthia Wesley, and Denise McNair. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. speaks. "This afternoon, we gather in the quiet of the sanctuary to pay our last tribute to these beautiful children of God. These children, unoffending, innocent, and beautiful, were the victims of one of the most vicious and tragic crimes ever perpetrated against humanity, and yet they died nobly. They are the martyred heroines of a holy crusade for freedom and dignity. And so in this afternoon, in a real sense, they have something to say to each of us in their deaths. They say to us that we must be concerned not merely about who murdered them, but about the system, the way of life, the philosophy which produced the murderers." John Lewis reflects, "We all knew what Dr. King meant. Governor George Wallace had started his term declaring segregation forever. And 2 weeks before the bombing, he was quoted in the paper saying, 'What this country needs is a few first-class funerals.' Unless we could give all its citizens a political voice, Alabama would continue to elect people like George Wallace." That evening after the funeral, Diane Nash and I met with Dr. King to present a plan. She and James Bevel were now married and raising a little girl of their own. News of the bombing had shaken them up so badly that she came to Birmingham to propose an all-out revolution. Diane Nash speaks, "Dr. King, when children are murdered, we can tell people not to fight only if we offer them a way by which justice can be served without violence." Some in SCLC, the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, had talked about marching to Montgomery to place a funeral wreath on the Alabama State House, but Diane's plan went far beyond. Her action in Montgomery would recruit a nonviolent army of thousands of young people to pour into the city, cutting off roads, trains, airports, phone lines, electricity, and local businesses until the state government was completely shut down. There were two objectives: force Governor Wallace out of office and allow every adult in Alabama to vote. Dr. King responds, "I agree, Diane, but an undertaking of this magnitude would take significant resources." Diane speaks, "We have to do something. We have to give people a direction, a constructive outlet for their pain and frustration." Dr. King speaks, "And we will, but not this way." John Lewis reflects, "I wasn't angry with Dr. King. I knew he had other concerns to weigh, but we couldn't do nothing. We had to respond, even if it was just SNCC, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, acting on its own, as we had many times before. So we decided to step up our activities in a small city in Dallas County, deep in the Alabama Black Belt, where Bernard Lafayette and others had spent the last year organizing to register black voters. Selma."
I appreciate your patience with us going over the 3 minutes. My father was a Muslim immigrant, so I'm pretty sure I won't end up in anybody's cabinet. October 7th, 1963. In Dallas County, you could only register to vote on the first and third Mondays of the month. So while I, John Lewis, was in jail, SNCC decided to use the next voter registration day to stage its largest mobilization yet. The effort quickly found a name, Freedom Day. James Baldwin, the federal government is not doing what it is supposed to do. Even renowned author James Baldwin came with his brother to support those in line. It was hot, but no one was allowed to leave the line for water or to use the bathroom. Even if they could, the colored bathrooms had been locked. At noon, the registrar of voters left for a 2-hour lunch break. Vroom! By that time, only 12 people had been admitted to see the registrar. 15 minutes later, the Alabama State Troopers arrived. Room, squeak. Thud, thud, fapash. Major Joe Smelly, that's his real name. Major Joe Smelly was the trooper in charge that day. If any of y'all leave that line for any reason, if you have to go to the bathroom or you're thirsty, any reason whatsoever, you're not coming back here. You're not coming back, you hear? And you agitators, you're not allowed to bring them anything. No food, no water. It became a battle of wills. After a few more hours, some folks standing in line were looking like they might collapse. Sheriff Clark, finally Jim Foreman, and Amelia Boynton, a local businesswoman who had been organizing registration efforts here for decades, you're the man, made an appeal. Sheriff Clark, these people could die. Let us bring them some water. Some haven't had anything to drink in 5 or 6 hours. Sheriff Clark, it doesn't seem like a very Christian thing to let people drop dead on your courthouse steps. Well, if they're so thirsty, then they can get out of line and get something to drink. Ain't nobody stopping them. But if I see any of you N-words trying to bring them anything, if I see you so much as talking to them, I'll arrest you for molesting people trying to register to vote. The SNCC field secretaries Avery Williams and Chico Neblett couldn't wait any longer. Thud, thwack, dzz, thabash. Still, the line held and no one left. That's it. 4:30, the courthouse is closed. To us, making it through the entire day without a mass arrest was progress. Though only a few people were able to see the registrar, we felt it was a victory. I'll just say this. I just got back from a campaign. I took off and went down to Georgia, where I grew up. And I saw this exact same thing happening in the state of Georgia. They weren't allowed to bring food or water or what they call comfort items to people standing in line to vote. I was comforted by the fact that we weren't fighting the registration battle. We were fighting the battle to vote, of actually showing up and having enough precincts. So we made progress, but we are not there yet. Thank you.
Grace Lynn. It's very difficult to go after that, but I will do my best. My book is called When the Sea Turned to Silver. Ah, they feed me much better since you arrived, the stonecutter said, as the dungeon door slammed closed. He picked up a bowl of rice and pushed it toward Amma. A small bowl of rice every other day, Amma said, taking the bowl, does not seem like good feeding to me. They used to forget for 3-4 days, sometimes a week, the stonecutter said. And now they leave a light. It is because of you, of course. Me, Amma said, scooping the rice with her cold fingers. Yes, the stonecutter said. You misjudge those who honor you. They do not think you can predict the future or save you from catastrophe. They honor you because you are the storyteller. It does not seem like something that would earn the respect of men such as these, Amma said. Almost all men respect the storyteller, the stonecutter said. You can make time disappear. You can bring us to places we have never dreamed. You can make us feel sorrow and joy and peace. You have great magic. You flatter me, Amma said. I do not think I am what you say. The stonecutter laughed. How could you not be, he said. Don't the soldiers treat you as kindly as they can? Are you not now covered by a guard's own coat? How selfish I am, Amma said. You have been cold much longer than me. You should have this coat. The guard gave it to you, storyteller, the stonecutter said. Keep it. Instead, give me another story. Very well, Amma said. What kind of story would you like? Tell me a story about eating something delicious, the stonecutter said, so I can imagine I am eating something other than plain rice. And this is the story of the stolen peach bite. Emperor Zhu was called the son of heaven because he was indeed somehow related to the immortal queen mother of the heavens. And even though the relation must have been distant, the queen mother still looked upon him with great favor. For his 60th birthday celebration, the queen mother came. A full chariot pulled by unicorns burst from a cloud and descended. The thousand of acrobats, singers, and dancers and guests froze at a shocked standstill. However, while the light of the stars on the queen mother's crown was brighter than all the lanterns combined, it was the peach she held in her hand that everyone stared at. Zhu, the queen mother said, your character is too flawed for me to grant you immortality, so instead I bring you this peach of longevity. This peach will grant you 999 more years of life. I hope with these extra years, you will be able to merit immortality. All, including the emperor, sank to the floor in deference, and one of the queen's companions had to nudge a servant to rise in order to take the peach. As the emperor stammered his gratitude, the queen mother nodded to him and gave the sea of bowed heads a glance of acknowledgement. Then the unicorns reared and leaped, and she and her entourage disappeared back into the sky. For a moment, the emperor and his guests could only stare up at the heavens. If it were not for the peach, all would have doubted the reality of the queen mother's visit. But the glorious golden peach was casting a warm glow. The emperor, already licking his lips, waved his hand for the peach to be brought to him. The crowd parted and watched in hushed silence as the trembling servant carried the peach as if leading a procession. The sweet fragrance wafted through the air like an intoxicating wine, and it was not only the emperor's mouth that watered. But just as the peach was almost within arm's distance of the emperor, someone broke through the mesmerized crowd and grabbed it. After a brief stunned moment, the emperor barked an order, and the guards clamored. They swarmed upon the attempted thief, who collapsed to the floor. But with him fell the peach. It rolled on the floor toward the emperor, and all gazed in horror as they saw that a bite had been taken out of it. For a while, the moment of shock had been short, it had been long enough. The golden skin of the peach had been torn open, and where a chunk of flesh was now missing, a sweet, sticky juice was dripping like crystal beads gliding off of a string. The emperor would not take the first bite of his peach. Enraged, the emperor had the thief brought before him. To everyone's surprise, it was a magistrate who was distantly connected to the emperor by marriage. By all accounts, he was well-liked, but all favor had disappeared with a bite of the peach. How dare you take a bite of my peach, the emperor roared. I shall have you executed. Forgiveness, your exalted majesty, the magistrate said, prostrating himself. But if I have eaten from the peach of longevity, how can I be killed? Fool, the emperor said, you have stolen some extra years of life, but you are not invincible. That bite of peach may protect you from sickness and age, but you can still be killed. Ah, said the magistrate, who, contrary to the emperor's words, was not a fool. But that peach was given to you by the queen mother to give you time to become worthy of immortality. Do you think she would be pleased if the first thing you do upon receiving it is to order me to my death? At that, the emperor hesitated, for there was truth in his words. He grunted with annoyance. It occurred to him that he had yet to eat his peach and that he should consume it before any more disasters occurred. Just take him away, the emperor thundered, and bring me my peach. And so the official was taken away, and the emperor finally received his peach. And while the emperor ate it with much delight, even he must have wondered how much sweeter the peach would have been if he had gotten the first bite. But Emperor Zhu did not live an extra 999 years, the stonecutter said. He was the last of the Ming emperors, killed by the soldiers of Emperor Shang. Well, that just proves Emperor Zhu was right, Ama said. The peach could keep him from getting old or sick, but he could still be killed. Even immortality is not invincibility. That's true, the stonecutter said. I wonder what happened to that official. Executed later, do you think? I don't know, Ama said slowly. I wonder. I wonder how many extra years the official stole with that one bite, the stonecutter said, laughing as he brought the rice bowl to his face. Perhaps he is still alive and wishes he had taken another bite. Perhaps, Ama said, but she did not laugh as she swallowed her rice. Thank you.
No, I don't know how this all shakes down tomorrow, so I may not have the opportunity to say this publicly, but have to say, Congressman Lewis, sir, brother, father, Lewis, I would have been honored to be nominated for this award any year, but I have to say, it is especially, especially special this year with you, and I just need you to know that in case I can't say it tomorrow. Chapter one, World Records. Check this out. So this dude named Andrew Dahl, he holds the world record for blowing up the most balloons with his nose. And I'm not really sure how he found out that that was some kind of special talent. And I can't even imagine how much snot be in those balloons. But hey, it's a thing, and apparently Andrew's the best at it. There's also this lady named Charlotte Lee who holds the world record for owning the most rubber ducks. Now, here's what's weird about that. I mean, why would you even own one rubber duck, let alone 5,631? I mean, come on. And me, I probably hold the world record for knowing about the most world records. That and for eating the most sunflower seeds. Let me guess, sunflower seeds, Mr. Charles practically shouts from behind the counter of what he calls his country store, even though we live in a city. Mr. Charles, who, by the way, looks just like James Brown if James Brown were white, has been ringing me up for sunflower seeds 5 days a week for about 3 years now. He can barely hear a thing, which is why he's always yelling at everybody and everybody's always yelling at him. His store is a straight-up scream fest, not to mention the extra sound effects from the loud TV he keeps behind the counter, cowboy movies on repeat. Mr. Charles is also the guy who gave me this book, The Guinness World Records, which is where I found out about Andrew Dahl and Charlotte Lee. He tells me I can set a record one day, a real record, be one of the world's greatest somethings, maybe. But I know one thing. Mr. Charles, he gotta hold the record for saying, let me guess, sunflower seeds, because he say that every single time I come in the store, which means I probably also already hold the record for responding loudly the exact same way. Let me guess, $1. That's my comeback. Said it a gazillion times. And then I slap a buck in the palm of his wrinkly hand and he puts that bag of seeds in mine. How about the sunflower seeds? I used to just put a whole bunch of them in my mouth at the same time, suck all the salt off, and spit them all out machine gun style. I could have probably set a world record in that, too. But now I've matured. Now I take my time, moving them around, positioning them for the perfect bite to pop open that shell, then carefully separating the seed from it with my tongue, then, and this is the hard part, keeping that little seed safe in the space between teeth and tongue, I spit the shells out, and finally, after all that, I chew the seed up. I'm like a master at it, even though honestly, sunflower seeds don't really taste like nothing. I'm not even sure it's really worth all the hassle, but I like the process anyway. You see, my dad used to eat sunflower seeds too. That's where I get it from. But he used to chew the whole thing up, the seeds, the shells, everything, just devour them like some kind of beast. See, when I was really young, I used to always ask him if a sunflower was gonna grow inside him since he ate the seeds so much. He was always watching some kind of game like football or basketball, and he'd turn to me just for a second, just long enough to not miss a play, and he'd say, "Sunflowers be all up in me, kid." Then he'd shake up the seeds in his palm like dice before throwing another bunch in his grill to chomp down on. But let me tell you something, my daddy, he was lying. Wasn't no sunflowers growing in him. Couldn't have been. I don't know a whole lot about sunflowers, but I know they're pretty, and I know girls like them, and I know the word sunflower is made up of two good words, and that man ain't got two good words in him or anything that any girl would like, because girls don't like men who try to shoot them and their son, and that's the kind of man he was.
So I'm Nicola Yoon, and the book is called The Sun is Also a Star. It's about a poetic boy named Daniel who tries to convince a science-minded girl named Natasha to fall in love with him over the course of 12 hours in New York City. And they only have 12 hours because Natasha's family is scheduled to be deported that evening. So I'm going to read a little from the prologue and then one from each of their points of view. Carl Sagan said that if you want to make an apple pie from scratch, you must first invent the universe. When he says from scratch, he means from nothing. He means from a time before the world even existed. If you want to make an apple pie from nothing at all, you have to start with the Big Bang and exploding universes, neutrons, ions, atoms, black holes, suns, moons, ocean tides, the Milky Way, Earth, evolution, dinosaurs, extinction-level events, platypuses, Homo erectus, Cro-Magnon man, etc. You have to start at the beginning. You must invent fire. You need water and fertile soil and seeds. You need cows and people to milk them, and more people to turn that milk into butter. You need wheat and sugarcane and apple trees. You need chemistry and biology. For a really good apple pie, you need the arts. For an apple pie that can last for generations, you need the printing press and the Industrial Revolution, and maybe even a poem. To make a thing as simple as an apple pie, you have to create the whole wide world. Daniel. Local teen accepts destiny, agrees to become a doctor, stereotype. It's Charlie's fault that my summer, and now fall, has been one absurd headline after another. Charles J. Wanbei, AKA Charlie, my older brother, firstborn son of a firstborn son, surprised my parents and all their friends and the entire gossiping Korean community of Flushing, New York, by getting kicked out of Harvard University. Best school, my mother said when his acceptance letter arrived. Now he's been kicked out of best school, and all summer my mama frowns and doesn't quite believe and doesn't quite understand. Why are you grades so bad? They kick you out. Why they kick you out? Why not make you stay and study more? My dad says, not kick out. Required to withdraw, not the same as kick out. Charlie grumbles, it's just temporary, only for two semesters. Under this unholy barrage of my parents' confusion and shame and disappointment, even I almost feel bad for Charlie, almost. Natasha, my mom says it's time for me to give up now and that what I'm doing is futile. She's upset, so her accent is thicker than usual and every statement is a question. You don't think it's time for you to give up now, Tasha. You don't think what you're doing is futile. She draws out the first syllable of futile for a second too long. My dad doesn't say anything. He's mute with anger or impotence, I'm never sure which. His frown is so deep and so complete that it's hard to imagine his face with another expression. If this were even just a few months ago, I'd be sad to see him like this. But now I don't really care. He's the reason we're all in this mess. Peter, my 9-year-old brother, is the only one of us happy with this turn of events. Right now, he's packing his suitcase and playing No Woman, No Cry by Bob Marley. Old school packing music, he called it. My mom is right, of course. What I'm doing is futile. Still, I grab my headphones, my physics textbook, and some comics. If I have time to kill, maybe I can finish up my homework and read. Peter shakes his head at me. Why are you bringing that? He asks, meaning the textbook. We're leaving, Tasha. You don't have to turn in homework. Peter has just discovered the power of sarcasm. He uses it every chance he gets. I don't bother responding to him. Just put on my headphones and head for the door. Back soon, I say to my mom. She kisses her teeth and turns away. I remind myself that she's not upset with me. Tasha, it's not you me upset with, you know. It's something as she says a lot these days. I'm going to the United States Citizenship and Immigration Services building in downtown Manhattan to see if anyone there can help me. We are undocumented immigrants and we're being deported tonight. Today's my last chance to convince someone, or fate, to help me find a way to stay in America. To be clear, I don't believe in fate, but I am desperate.
Please give it up for your Young People's Literature finalists.
Young People's Literature is not playing games. Oh my goodness, your fiction, y'all better look out. They're coming for you, that was amazing. Okay, we're gonna have a 5-minute intermission, and then we're gonna come back for poetry.
That's right.
And fiction.
And fiction.
All right. Okay, ladies, now let's get information. This has been amazing. Thank you for being here tonight. Give yourselves a round of applause. I'm feeling things. I had to reapply makeup and just, it's like on a. Okay, are you ready for our next two categories? It is time for poetry. Daniel Borzutzky.
Rita Dove.
Peter Gizzi.
Jay Hopler.
And Solmaz Sharif. Give them a round of applause.
The Devouring Economy of Nature, from The Performance of Becoming Human. Let's begin at the end, she said. The best way to end a sentence is with the word blank. It is midnight and I am lonely and your blank is the blank of my blank. He ran through the party that was thrown to celebrate the hanging of the other body. He trampled cold chicken or biscuits, or he ran through the silhouettes of the hanging bodies, or he possessed the fortitude needed to refuse to begin another act of language. I refuse to write the middle of the story. There is water everywhere. There is a flood on my street, and I am sleeping in a body that is much too big for my bed. In fact, I am sleeping in a bed that is much too big for my house. The flood has changed the proportions, house to bed to body, or at least my perception of the proportions. Did you hear the one about the immigrant laborer who was run over by a tractor? In his pocket was a photograph of his cousin Ava, a 13-year-old in a refugee camp in another country. As the tractor ran him over, he kept shouting to his fellow workers, please, somebody marry Ava, somebody marry Ava. And to mourn the death of the mutilated workers, the children sang a song called Other People's Bodies. They sang it to the tune of a current popular song. There was a dance routine that involved hand motions and little hops and the thrusting of booties in and out. And as the song developed, the progression of data became increasingly relevant. For as the children sang, they slowly began to understand that they would never see their parents again, that they had been taken from their homes and tossed into the pools in order to fulfill the required data specifications outlined by the city, the state, and the country. Or A barbarian and an economist walk into a bar. The barbarian says, I dreamt we were in a swimming pool and you were swimming towards me. I was sitting on the wall, and when you got to the wall dissolved into the water and the pool stretched out endlessly, and there were hundreds of children swimming in the pool and they were looking for their parents. There were men in orange wetsuits painting lines throughout the water, over the water, and the lines were different colors and they stuck to the surface of the water, and we understood that certain colors meant certain things, and you picked up a drowning child and said, here is a small piece of data. I won't tell you what this data means in relation to the other data that will determine the relationship between your desire to eat the children and the future prosperity of the nation. The economist orders two martinis and says to the barbarian, there is something frozen here. I see you standing in front of the pool, and I know that the you who is standing there is the you who has uttered this sentence so many times before. When you spit out the sentence, they will say that it did not come from your mouth, that it came from the mouth of the person who is performing this act of being you. In other words, linguistic theory opens the door to the possibility that we are not ethically responsible for our actions. And the barbarian says, even if money doesn't exist, there will always be an audience for economists. And they take the water from the river and put it in the back of several trucks. And from the dried up river, there emerges a country. And in the country, there are children who have been invented by people who made money in things that don't actually exist. And they don't say, why are you taking the water from the river? And they don't think, why are you shaving the fur from the bodies of our dogs? The children sit on the sofa placed perfectly in a picturesque location on the river. The dogs are arranged so that they rest in front of the sofa. The photographer asks the children to smile so that the rest of the world can see how well we treat the displaced people. Do you want to see what you look like? The photographer says to the children. The children look at their images without recognition, stuck as they are in the fantasy life of the economists. And the barbarian says, do we really need these kids? Do I really need this job? Three dogs guard the two children. I will write their story, but I will not understand it. The doctor says, yes, in Illinois, we love a war between states across borders, both real and imagined. Or, did you hear the one about the boy who was thrown into the fire? His charred meat was hacked up with a cleaver and fed to dogs while his parents watched from a cage. The economist, formerly of the working class, only got married so that he could demonstrate that it was possible for a, quote, kid like me to move into high society. According to the data, it is impossible for rich people to be friends with poor people. This, according to the data, is true in all societies.
I'm going to read one poem. It's based on an actual event. It took place in 1937 in the Dominican Republic. 20,000 Haitian blacks, cane workers, were executed by the dictator General Rafael Trujillo for not being able to pronounce the Spanish word for parsley. Parsley, the cane fields. There is a parrot imitating spring in the palace, its feathers parsley green. Out of the swamp, the cane appears to haunt us, and we cut it down. El General searches for a word. He is all the world there is. Like a parrot imitating spring, we lie down screaming as rain punches through, and we come up green. We cannot speak an R. Out of the swamp, the cane appears, and then the mountain we call in whispers, Catalina. The children gnaw their teeth to arrowheads. There is a parrot imitating spring. El General has found his word, Perejil. Who says it lives? He laughs, teeth shining out of the swamp. The cane appears in our dreams, lashed by wind and streaming, and we lie down. For every drop of blood, there is a parrot imitating spring. Out of the swamp, the cane appears. The palace. The word the general's chosen is parsley. It is fall when thoughts turn to love and death. The general thinks of his mother, how she died in the fall, and he planted her walking cane at the grave, and it flowered, each spring stolidly forming four star blossoms. The general pulls on his boots. He stomps to her room in the palace, the one without curtains, the one with a parrot and a brass ring. As he paces, he wonders, who can I kill today? and for a moment, the little knot of screams is still. The parrot, who has traveled all the way from Australia in an ivory cage, is coy as a widow practicing spring. Ever since the morning his mother collapsed in the kitchen while baking skull-shaped candies for the Day of the Dead, the general has hated sweets. He orders pastries brought up for the bird. They arrive dusted with sugar on a bed of lace. The knot in his throat starts to twitch. He sees his boots the first day in battle splashed with mud and urine as a soldier falls at his feet, amazed. How stupid he looked at the sound of artillery. "I never thought it would sing," the soldier said, and died. Now the general sees the fields of sugarcane lashed by rain and streaming. He sees his mother's smile, the teeth gnawed to arrowheads. He hears the Haitians sing without R's as they swing the great machetes. Catalina, they sing. Catalina, mi madre, mi amor en muerte. God knows his mother was no stupid woman. She could roll an R like a queen. Even a parrot can roll an R. In the bare room, the bright feathers arch in a parody of greenery as the last pale crumb disappears under the blackened tongue. Someone calls out his name in a voice so like his mother's. A startled tear splashes the tip of his right boot. My mother, my love in death. The general remembers the tiny green sprigs men of his village wore in their capes to honor the birth of a son. He will order many, this time, to be killed for a single beautiful word.
Hi, I'm going to read three poems from my book, Archaeophonics. Sentences in a synapse field. For I wanted sound to dig into sound, for snow and blood, for wine and mirrors, for electrons and electricity, for debris, for damaged art, our collective fortune, future. For as long as there have been soldiers, there have been poets. For as long as poets, there has been a bridge. For I wanted to hold a room in silence for debris flooding back into a wave. For as long as particles a charge, for it should be incredulity to be alive. For these things it can be told until mystery becomes elegy. For it was March going into April, for the day was speaking, the day for what you thought, for what you buried, for who you are. When orbital proximity feels creepy. Right now, there are teenage microwaves screaming through your body while you are having text with me. This is the moment I'll need you to sing with me. I'm making my way in some dark room looking for other structures to love. From the left, something speaking I can't identify. The floor goes unfixed and moving, and this doesn't happen only at night, but during the day when I don't want to think on it. That I saw a blood orange ball caught out my window, that I'm listening to light, and it said time. I'm listening to time. It says, ha, you need to be howling at bloody torn space, need to be spooked out of your hidey hole and its glowing mess. But I love this ball I'm riding on, the strange hunk of metal and rock whizzing around my loves and my loving, the fact I spin and it spins and everything is spinning close up. From far away, it's so cool. I guess they call this physics, or they call it laws. If they're so well made, why do we suffer? I thought the day was opening, but now I see it's already gone.
Outside, the cruel dove has a broken window. The day isn't friendly. Who are you to me? A way to understand the floor that holds me up and leaves me standing. I don't know where to go, me, Tuesday at 5 p.m. What does it mean to be in a room, any room? The wind banging against the clabbered. I know enough to see the cracked pane isn't going to be fixed anytime soon. Who has time for such things in the song? Breaking, blooming, the wobble of light on wood grain late in the day, in the loneliness of orange, in the loveliness of orange. And then a short poem, the title poem, Archaeophonics, which means the retrieval or the archaeology of lost and buried sound. Archaeophonics. I'm just visiting this voice. I'm just visiting the molecular structures that say what I am saying. I am just visiting the world at this moment, and it's on fire. It's always been on fire. I'm saying this, and it's saying me. That's how it works, seesaw-like. The archive in the mouth, and the archive is on fire. That's the story, the sun in the body, and the body in the sun. It was like this, just like this, the world that's coming toward me, and the world around me. Around me are words saying this, saying fire, saying something, or all of it. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm going to read three poems from my book, The Abridged History of Rainfall. Winter Night Full of Stars. I am a winter night full of stars. I am that star, the one you thought was a plane. I am the shadow of that plane casting its blackness over the lake house like a shroud. And I am that shroud, black, embroidered with stars, under which you grew cold that January night, laid out upon your catafalque of down. And those feathers were as snow in that mortuary air, floated like snowflakes in that mortuary air, when the wind came up. And when the wind died down, they were as snow upon the ground. Am I the smoke drifting through the bare branches of a Japanese maple? Or am I the Japanese maple smoke drifting through its bare branches? It is not smoke, but light burning to a fine ash. And in that darkness, may you, like those dark blooms, shine. Come, oh, let us to dust together. May 25. Behind the banyan trees, the mansions. Behind the mansions, the lagoon. In the lagoon, a mooring of sailboats, wind in the rigging, hull slap and groan. Where is everybody? The sound of people playing in their pools, well, there isn't any. The streets are empty, the moon like a moon jelly, beating its slow float in the not quite dark. In the gardens of the mooring country club, the lights have come on, rice paper lanterns printed with cherry blossoms. Oh, this unstarred sky, and the smell of the starred jasmine, the fleshy, resplendent scent of the gardenia. Is this where I say, I miss you? Where I say, Father, isn't there anything in this evening's long cortege of bloom as beautiful as it used to be? Like the sound of an empty ship drifting through fog, like a sweet, despicable imitation of morning. A piteousness of doves is cooing in the banyan trees. The Coast Road. On nights like these, when the house is too quiet, I walk into the moonlit yard and listen. The wind in the oak tree says, nothing ever happens when you want it to. The crickets in the witch grass say, there will never be an end to this droning of the surf, no end to this drowning of the surfer, the tired tread of traffic in the distance. It's not what one listens to that matters, but what one listens for. From the rafters of the back porch, the remnants of a vespiary are hanging, its gray walls stripped thin by poison and last night's rain. A bird takes flight, the moon ignites, the evening weeps its traffic lights. Isn't there a bird somewhere whose call sounds like, I'm sorry, I'm sorry? What silence is there deep enough to follow a cry like that?
The U.S. Department of Defense has its own dictionary, and in that dictionary has redefined the word look to mean, in mind warfare, a period during which a mind circuit is receptive of an influence. One poem. Look. It matters what you call a thing. Exquisite, a lover called me, exquisite. Whereas, well, if I were from your culture living in this country, said the man outside the 2004 Republican National Convention, I would put up with that for this country. Whereas I felt the need to clarify, you would put up with torture, you mean, and he proclaimed yes. Whereas what is your life? Whereas years after they look down from their jets and declare my mother's Abadan block probably destroyed, we walked by the villas, the faces of buildings torn off into dioramas, and recorded it on a handheld camcorder. Whereas it could take as long as 16 seconds between the trigger pulled in Las Vegas and the Hellfire missile landing in Mazar-e-Sharif, after which they will ask, did we hit a child? No, a dog, they will answer themselves. Whereas the federal judge at the sentencing hearing said, I want to make sure I pronounce the defendant's name correctly. Whereas this lover would pronounce my name and call me exquisite and lay the floor lamp across the floor, softening even the light. Whereas the lover made my heat rise so that if heat sensors were trained on me, they could read my thermal shadow through the roof and through the wardrobe. Whereas, it's not like seeing a dead body walking to the grocery store here. It's not like that. It's a rock, you know? It's a rock. It's kind of like acceptable to see that there. It was kind of like seeing a dead dog or a dead cat lying. Whereas I thought if he would look at my exquisite face or my father's, he would reconsider. Whereas, you mean I should be disappeared because of my family name? And he answered, yes, that's exactly what I mean, adding that his wife helped draft the Patriot Act. Whereas the federal judge wanted to be sure he was pronouncing the defendant's name correctly and said he had read all the exhibits, which included the letter I wrote to cast the defendant in a loving light. Whereas today we celebrate things like his transfer to a detention center closer to home. Whereas his son has moved across the country. Whereas I made nothing happen. Whereas ye know not what shall be on the morrow, for what is your life? It is even a thermal shadow. It appears so little and then vanishes from the screen. Whereas I cannot control my own heat, and it can take as long as 16 seconds between the trigger, the Hellfire missile, and a dog, they will answer themselves. Whereas a dog, they will say, now, therefore, let it matter what we call a thing. Let it be the exquisite face for at least 16 seconds. Let me look at you. Let me look at you in a light that takes years to get here.
Another round of applause for all of our poetry finalists.
The final group this evening, the National Book Award finalists in fiction. Chris Batchelder.
Yeah, well, you know, let the spirit move you, honey. Paulette Jiles.
Karan Mahajan.
reading on behalf of Colson Whitehead, Bonnie Turpin,
and Jacqueline Woodson.
Thank you. How wonderful to be here tonight, and what an honor and a privilege to read with the fellow finalists. Thank you. Through the windows of the dining area, the hotel parking lot shone darkly in the cold rain. The lights above the lot were on, casting a weak yellow glow in the mist. At the offensive lineman's table, Gil spoke of the tiny hinges of a dollhouse roof. His Mark May jersey was radiant against the dun breads of breakfast. At a nearby table, the conversation drifted inevitably toward vasectomy and timeshare. Wesley said they could now cauterize the vas deferens in a scalpel-free procedure. Gary was adamant about an A-frame chalet in the Smokies. Vince heard the men out nodding, but he said he was just not ready. Suit yourself, Gary said, leaving the table for more instant oatmeal. Later full, the men pulled their chairs away from their breakfast tables. They had nowhere to be until 10 o'clock. They sat, leaned back, crossed their legs at the ankles, at the knees. They drank coffee, picked at pastries. They talked, read complimentary newspapers, played games on phones, took photographs of themselves, stared at the mute television. One man worked a crossword. Another put new laces in his cleats. Another used the sharp corner of a business card to remove food from his teeth. Another performed a magic trick with a quarter and upside-down cups. George did chair yoga. Like the dog that licks its testicles, they refilled their coffee cups because they could. The coffee was bad, but its poor quality served to strengthen the community. The day was in front of them. The dining area, seen as a whole, appeared to be a sight of both great torpor and great vitality, as the sheer variety of indolence manifested as an energetic bustle. If asked to specify the best part of the weekend, not one of the men would think to name this languorous interlude in the dining area, and yet there was no time better than this. This was the best time, this brief span of Saturday morning. It was not an event, could not be named or considered. Consequently, the men could enjoy it without pressure, anxiety, or self-consciousness. Indeed, without awareness, they could enjoy it without enjoying it. If they were aware of it as a potentially enjoyable event, post-breakfast relaxation, 9:15 to 10 in the dining area, then it would almost certainly cease to be such an enjoyable event. Disappointment was the freight of expectation. Unbeknownst to the men, this was what they came here for every year. They were enjoying their morning, but they did not realize it. The good moments, it is true, were always this way, interstitial and unacknowledged. They craved occasion but did not understand it. Halfway through their lives, considerably more than halfway in several cases, the men knew nothing of their own vast contentment. A woman entered the dining area with a boy. She paid no attention to the men in their jerseys. She briefly surveyed the continental breakfast. Then she filled two cups with orange juice and put lids on the cups. She wrapped food in napkins and began to arrange the food in her large purse. The boy, 8 or 9, shuffled away from her, peered into the fruit bowl. He withdrew 2 apples and an orange. "Don't touch anything," his mother said. Without looking up from the buffet. The boy turned toward the dining area and he began to juggle the fruit. The men tapped each other on the shoulder, shifted in their chairs to watch. They knew too well how it would end, the bruised fruit rolling beneath tables. The boy scolded once more. His face glowed with concentration. He had taught himself to juggle in his bedroom, and he was good. He would not drop the fruit. The men began to relax. They began to miss their own children. It was the best kind of missing, without pang or ache. They did not actually want to be with their children. They had fond thoughts and were grateful for the distance that generated those thoughts. "Let's go, Brian," the woman said, "right now." She zipped her bulging purse and walked toward the lobby. As abruptly as he had begun, the boy stopped juggling. He wiped each piece of fruit with a napkin, placed them into the bowl, and then jogged after the woman. "We're late," the woman said. Gary, tugging at the neck of his Lawrence Taylor jersey, muttered an unkind word about the woman, and Jeff laughed. The more thoughtful among the men were more thoughtful. Thank you.
Thank you for having me here, and thank you for this medal and being a finalist. This story is about an old man who's in his 70s, and he is an itinerant newsreader in 1870 in Texas, in North Texas, and he's asked to return a small girl to her who's been captive with the Kiowa for 4 years and thinks of herself as a Kiowa, and he is asked to return her to her parents, and he takes on this task, and it's not easy. And he has a strong feeling that nobody wants this girl. The Kiowa gave her up. He's not sure about her parents. And he does news readings. There was a good crowd, and the captain, his name is Captain Kidd. There was a good crowd, and he heard the coins ringing into the paint can at the entrance, a dime ahead. He greeted the crowd as always, and then he shook out the London Times. It was in this way he asked people to enter another realm of the mind, places far away and mysterious, brought to them by details which they did not understand, but which entranced them. He read of the attempt by the British colonial government to enumerate the peoples under their rule, a census, in short, and the rebellion of the Hindu tribes against the census takers because married women were not permitted to say aloud the names of their husbands. Nods, they are all beyond rational thought in those far countries. He read aloud about a great windstorm in London that toppled chimney pots. What is a chimney pot? He could see it in their faces. And then of the new packing plants in Chicago, which would take any amount of cattle if they could just get them. And in the crowd were men who were contemplating driving cattle all the way to Missouri if they could evade the savage tribes. And they listened with deep interest. And the captain read of the Irish pouring into New York City, ragged crowds unloaded from the passenger steamer Aurora and the railroad driving into the plains, into the new state of Nebraska, of another eruption of Popocatépetl in Mexico City, anything but Texas politics. Someone called, "Why are you not reading from Governor Davis's state journal?" And the captain folded his newspapers and he said, "Sir, you know very well why." He leaned forward over the podium. His white hair shone, his gold-rimmed glasses winked in the bullseye lantern beam. He was the image of elderly wisdom and reason. "Because there'd be a fistfight here within moments, if not shooting. Men have lost the ability to discuss any political event in Texas in a reasonable manner. There is no debate, only force. And the point of fact, regard the soldiers beyond the door." So he slapped his newspapers into the portfolio and said, "I'm an aggregator of news from distant places, and as for the Austin paper and the Herald, you can read those for yourselves." The captain shut the flap on his portfolio and buckled it tight, "and fight among yourselves for your own, on your own time and not during my reading." He stepped down from the stage, and among the crowd filtering out, he saw with a dropping feeling the pale-haired man and the two caddos he had last seen in Wichita Falls, and perhaps in Spanish Fort. The blond man sat relaxed in a theater chair with one ankle cocked up over the other leg and his hat on the point of his knee. He was watching the captain. And the captain stepped down and shook hands with people after his reading, thinking perhaps he had very briefly escorted the people's mind into the lands of the imagination. Far places, crisp ice mountains in the Arctic, and falling chimney pots and tropical volcanoes. "Captain," said the blonde man. He stood up. "My name is Alme. And these are your friends, these caddos," said Captain Kidd. "They are," the blonde man put on his hat. The captain said, "You followed me from Wichita Falls. I saw you in Spanish Fort." "I have business here and there," said Alme. And he said, "How much do you want for the girl?" Captain Kidd stopped stone cold, and for a moment, a long moment, he stood expressionless and completely still. "I was wrong," he said. He thought, "Somebody does want the girl." He put on his own hat and settled it carefully on his white hair, and he looked down at Alme, several inches shorter. Alme said, "You know, the army doesn't patrol the roads here like they do up on the Red River. I could catch you out on the road and just take her, you know. But I'm being a fair and a straightforward man with you. How much do you want?" And the captain said, "Well, I hadn't settled on a price or found a buyer." "No," said the captain, "nor found a buyer." Well, let's consider it. I'm not close-fisted. I pay for what I want. Do you now? Captain Kidd had left the .38 revolver back in the hotel room, and it was too big to pack around under the three-button frock coat he wore for readings, and it was heavy, and perhaps it was best, because the feeling that was present overwhelming him now would have led him to draw it and shoot the man on the spot. And then where would Johanna be when he was in jail? Yes, tell me the name of anybody that says otherwise, said Almay. I couldn't be bothered, said Captain Kidd. Of course, I would want assurance that the girl would be well treated. Oh, yes, yes. At least she'll get paid for it. Blonde girls are premium, premium. Do tell, said the captain amiably. His mind was racing ahead like a steam engine into the next hour, the next day, how much ammunition he had, if they knew where he was going, and if they did, if they knew what road he was going to take. And he said, I'll tell you what, Almay. Meet me tomorrow morning at the Tyler Stage Roadhouse at about 7 o'clock in the morning, and we'll work out a price. I didn't take in much tonight, and I'm in need of funds. Good. Almay's eyelids seemed heavy. He had gray eyes and the thick and colorless skin of people from Scandinavia or Russia. He seemed half asleep, or he was dreaming of some other world that was not this world. It was a place fragmented and without illumination. So the captain walked fast through the unpaved streets to Gannis livery and called out to the oafish stableman. He harnessed the roan mare, backed her into the shafts, settled the collar, hooked up the trace chains, turned the wagon facing out, and he changed his clothes as fast as he had ever changed in his life. He flung into the wagon his bag of coins, wrapped up the remains of their supper in the frying pan. He trotted down the dark streets of Dallas to the hotel, a few dim-lit windows here and there, and he raced upstairs to his own room, packed the carpet bag, hefted it, ran to the next door, and he rapped hard and fast. Mrs. Gann had opened the door in a nightgown. She had been looking after the girl. Must have had 11 yards in the hem of that nightgown, her dark brown hair undone. Her mouth was open, and behind her, Johanna, the little captive girl, who thought of herself as a Kiowa, with her maple sugar hair and her eyes like glass marbles, sat up fully awake, ready for enemies, and planted both her square feet on the floor. Mrs. Gannett, said the captain, quick, we have to leave tonight. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Karan Mahajan. I'll be reading from the Association of Small Bombs. The scene I'm reading is set in New Delhi. It's the first two pages of the book. The bombing for which Mr. and Mrs. Khurana were not present was a flat percussive event that began under the bonnet of a parked white Maruti 800. Though, of course, that detail about the car could only be confirmed later. A good bombing begins everywhere at once. A crowded market also begins everywhere at once, and Lajpatnagar exemplified this type of tumult. A formless swamp of shacks that bubbled here and there with faces and rolling carts and sloping beggars. It probably held four seasons at once in its gigantic span, all of them hot. When you got from one end of the market to the other, the wooden carts with their shiny aluminum wheels had so rearranged themselves that the market you were in was technically no longer the market you had entered, a Heisenbergian nightmare of motion and ambiguity. So the truth of the matter is that no one really saw the parked car till it came apart in a dizzying flock of shards. Strange sights were reported. A blue fiberglass rooftop came uncorked from a shop and clattered down on a bus a few meters away. The bus braked, the rooftop slid forward, leaked a gorgeous stream of sand, and fell to the ground. The bus proceeded to crack it under its tires and keep going, its passengers dazed, even amused. In a great city, what happens in one part never perplexes the other parts. Back in the market, people collapsed, then got up, their hands pressed to their wounds as if they had smashed eggs against their bodies in hypnotic agreement and were unsure about what to do with the runny, bloody yolk. Most startling of all for the survivors and rescue workers both was the realization that the main dusty square was rooted so firmly by half a dozen massive trees, trees that had gone all but unnoticed in all those years, their shadows dingy with commerce, their branches cranked low with hanging wares, their droppings of mulberry collected and sold, until the bomb had loosened the green gums of the trees and sent down a shower of leaves, which Mr. Khurana kicked up on the ground as he tried to uncover the bodies of his two sons. But the leaves, turned crisp, shards themselves, offered nothing. His sons were dead at a nearby hospital, and he had come too late. The two boys were the sum total of the Khurana's children, 11 and 13, eager to be sent out on errands. And on this particular day, they had gone with a friend to pick up the Khurana's old TV, consigned to the electrician for perhaps the 10th time. But when Mr. Khurana was asked by friends what the children were doing there, he said, "They'd gone to pick up my watch from the watchman." His wife didn't stop him and in fact colluded in the lie. "All the watches were stopped," she said. "The way they know the time the bomb went off is by taking the average of all the stopped watches in the watchman's hut." Why lie? Why now? Well, because to admit to their high-flying friends that their children had not only died among the poor, but had been sent out on an errand that smacked of poverty, repairing an old TV, would have, in those tragic weeks that followed the bombing, undone the tightly laced nerves that held them together. But of course, they were poor, at least compared to their friends, and no amount of suave English, the sort that issued uncontrollably from their mouths, could change that. No amount of sobbing in Victorian sentences or chest beating before the Oxonian anchors on the news tonight who interviewed them, who stoked their outrage, could drape them or their dead children in the glow of foregone success. Mr. and Mrs. Khurana were 40 and 40, and they had suffered the defining tragedy of their lives, and so all other competing tragedies were relegated to mere facts of existence. For a month afterwards, they made do without the TV, which for all they knew was still sitting in the basement workshop of the electrician, its hidden berths of microchips heavy with dust, its screen screwed off and put face down on the floor, looking into nothing. They only caught their own mugs on the news tonight because a neighbor knocked on their door and welcomed them into his house to watch the news. He was friendly with them ever after. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Bonnie Turpin. I'm going to be reading for Colson Whitehead from his book, The Underground Railroad. This passage is a speech given by Elijah Lander, a biracial abolitionist and speaker who visits Valentine Farm, where the main character Cora has found safety. Here's one delusion, that we can escape slavery. We can't. Its scars will never fade. When you saw your mother sold off, your father beaten, your sister abused by some boss or master, did you ever think you would sit here today without chains, without the yoke among a new family? Everything you ever knew told you that freedom was a trick. Yet here you are. Still we run, tracking by the good full moon to sanctuary. Valentine Farm is a delusion. Who told you the Negro deserved a place of refuge? Who told you that you had that right? Every minute of your life's suffering has argued otherwise. By every fact of history, it can't exist. This place must be a delusion too. Yet, here we are. And America too is a delusion. The grandest one of all. The white race believes with all its heart that it is their right to take the land, to kill Indians, make war, enslave their brothers. This nation shouldn't exist. If there is any justice in the world, for its foundations are murder, theft, and cruelty. Yet here we are, I'm supposed to answer Mingo's call for gradual progress, for closing our doors to those in need. I'm supposed to answer those who think this place is too close to the grievous influence of slavery and that we should move west. I don't have an answer for you. I don't know what we should do. The word, we. In some ways, the only thing we have in common is the color of our skin. Our ancestors came from all over the African continent. It's quite large. Brother Valentine has the maps of the world in his splendid library. You can look for yourself. They had different ways of subsistence, different customs, spoke 100 different languages. And that great mixture was brought to America in the holds of slave ships. To the north, the south, their sons and daughters picked tobacco, cultivated cotton, worked on the largest estates and smallest farms. We are craftsmen and midwives and preachers and peddlers. Black hands built the White House, the seat of our nation's government. The word we. We are not one people, but many different people. How can one person speak for this great, beautiful race, which is not one race, but many, with a million desires and hopes and wishes for ourselves and our children? For we are Africans in America, something new in the history of the world, without models for what we will become. Color must suffice. It has brought us to this night, this discussion, and it will take us into the future. All I truly know is that we rise and fall as one. One colored family living next door to one white family. We may not know the way through the forest, but we can pick each other up when we fall, and we will arrive together.
I'm hoping one year the National Book Foundation does this in reverse alphabetical order. My name is Jacqueline Woodson. I'm reading from Another Brooklyn. Four girls, Sylvia, August, Gigi, and Angela. We stayed up late, watching television sitcoms, eating popsicles and bags of candy. Sylvia and I wore baby doll pajamas that felt obscene and made us giddy. We slow danced with each other. Angela showed us how to French kiss, and we spent hours practicing. We practiced until our bodies felt as though they were exploding. We whispered, "I love you," and meant it. We said, "This is scary," and laughed. When my boyfriend Jerome asked where I'd learned what I learned, I said, "Don't worry about it." Because he was 18 and I was nearly 14, and nothing mattered but hearing, "I love you," and believing he meant it. There were days when we sat in front of the television watching Clark Kent fall in love with Lois Lane and understood what it meant to hold secrets close. When Angela cried but wouldn't tell us why, we promised her our loyalty, reminded her that she was beautiful, said, "Knock, knock, Angela, let us in, let us in." We stroked the sharp knots of her cheekbones, moved our fingers gently over her lips, lifted her shirt and kissed her breast. We said, "You're so beautiful." We said, "Don't be afraid." We said, "Don't cry." When she danced, her dance told stories none of us were old enough to hear. The deep arch of her back, the long neck impossibly turned, the hands begging air into her chest. "What are you saying?" we begged. "Tell us what it is you need." But Angela was silent. On the 4th of July, my father took us all to the East River, where thousands of people crowded to watch fireworks explode above the water. Pressed against each other, Angela whispered into my ear, "I'm going to leave this place one day." I promised her we'd go with her, but Angela shook her head. Her straightened hair hot curled into a mushroom low over her brow and eyes and ears. She stared straight ahead at the fireworks. "Nah," she said, "y'all won't." That night, as New York and the rest of the country celebrated its independence, everywhere we looked, the world was red, white, and blue. We had shared a joint in the smoky bathroom of a crowded McDonald's and felt wild and free. On the subway home, someone's boombox played 50 Ways to Leave Your Lover, and we all laughed, singing along. "Hop on the bus, Gus, you don't need to discuss much." Angela nodding and saying, "You know, that's right." On a different planet, we could have been Lois Lane, or Tarzan's Jane, or Mary Tyler Moore, or Marlo Thomas. We could have thrown our hats up, twirled and smiled. We could have made it after all. We watched the shows, we knew the songs. We sang along when Mary was big-eyed and awed by Minneapolis. We dreamed with Marlo of someday hitting the big time. We took off with the Flying Nun, but we were young. And we were on Earth, heading home to Brooklyn. Thank you.
Please give a round of applause for our fiction finalists.
Please keep the applause going for all the finalists tonight. Let's give it up for the National Book Awards and the New School. Keep it going for yourselves for celebrating literature.
And most importantly, because all of these artists have honored us tonight, buy a book. Have a great night.
Books are for sale in the back from McNally Jackson.